And if that's not the way in which you arrived at service today, I hope it is the way that you will leave here today. I think that's a healthy place for us to be in a relationship with God, is to be absolutely desperate. It's all face, other. Good to see you. I don't do that to everybody. All right, it's good. I mean, I'm happy to see all of you. But yeah, I love it when I get caught off guard. But man, that's the key to the healthy, maturing, vibrant relationship with God, is when we just literally are desperate for Him every single day. So if that's not the appetite that you have for Him when you arrived, I hope that through music and prayer and the message, there becomes that quiet desperation for Him, because He makes all the difference in the world. Welcome today. Man, this is Memorial Sunday weekend, all right? People are usually one of three places today. They're either in church, mountain, or the lake. and some of our folks are at the other two places. But I'm glad that you are here today. Thanks for being here. It's great to have you. If you are a guest today, it's our honor and privilege to have you here. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to take one, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. We make a couple of promises. We're not going to come beat on your door. We're not going to bother you on the phone. But we would love to know of your presence here today and send to you in the mail information that tells you about the church, the ministries that we have, and the way in which we try to be salt and light in the community that we're a part of. So if you'd like that information, please just put it in the offering bag. And if later on you want to be harassed, let us know and we'll do that. But otherwise, we'll just put that information out. Let me highlight a few announcements and then some prayer requests that are not in your bulletin, and we will get further engaged in our worship today. Ladies, there is a special insert in the bulletin just for you. Giggles and goodies, okay? This is a special event that's coming up on August the 6th. It will be right here in the sanctuary. This is one of those events for you to invite your friends to, all right? This lady is a stand-up comedian who loves Jesus, all right? Obviously, God has a sense of humor. I'm reminded of that every single morning when I look in the mirror, all right? And this lady takes it to another level, and so with humor, she will challenge you as well as your friends or relatives about their relationship with Christ. Tickets are going to go on sale next Sunday. You can get them out in the pavilion before or after the service is starting next Sunday. Please note, there is an early bird price, all right? There's a savings if you buy them early, and we would like to know, particularly Fawn would love to know early, how many of you and your guests are going to be coming, because we can put 220 really comfortable in here, and if we're only going to end up with 150 or 160, then we would like to extend an invitation to another church or two that we have good relationships with and doing things together, that they would like to come and join us, all right, for that very special event. So ladies, this is for you. Think about that. Put it on your calendar, and then next Sunday, get your tickets, okay? This table up here looks pretty sparse, doesn't it? Has the baby bottles on it. Most of you know what these baby bottles are for. We start talking about them on Mother's Day. This is a fundraiser that we do every year between Mother's Day and Father's Day for the Pregnancy Care Center. It's called Change for Babies. You take this bottle home every day. You put your loose change in it. You bring it back by Father's Day. And last year, through this, we raised about $2,700, all right, through New Hope Church for Pregnancy Care Center. And they provide wonderful services to young ladies and to young dads, all right, at a very difficult time in their life. And so we love to be able to help them out. Here's the deal. This is the first time we've ever put them on Mother's Day out on a table in front of the church or out in the pavilion. And we just left it to you to come pick them up. In doing this for over 20 years, I've never had bottles left over. But this morning, I still had 22 bottles. So I took five over to the 8 o'clock service, because they're a much smaller crowd at 8 o'clock, and we gave away five of them in there, all right? I need to give away half this table in here today, okay, in this service, and then we'll do the other half in the last service. So who would like to have a Change for Babies bottle, okay? Catch, I'm throwing, they're very light, okay? Here we go, right there, here we go, right there, okay? I got to go to this side for a minute, so, okay, you're going to have, I'm trusting that you all can catch. Who we got right here? Okay, got one back there. Oh, good job. Okay. All right, okay, I'll go two more, because, well, okay, anybody else in here? Well, we'll get them all the way in here if we can. All right, this works. Okay, down there, okay, here we go. All right, here we are, Okay. Mark, grab those others. I think we're going to give them all away. There's one right down there. Okay. See, I told folks, because they were going to put it outside again, and I said, no, I said, I'm going to use peer pressure. See, it's easy just to walk by a table. There's a couple of hands back there, Mark. All right, we got them all? All right, we're finished. Okay, here's the deal. If we didn't get one to you, then sometime between now and Father's Day, you can just put something in an envelope and write on it, Pregnancy Care Center, okay? And it'll go to Pregnancy Care Center. Peer pressure is a wonderful thing, isn't it? You know, you walk by the table and you don't pick one up, but in here, hey, so anyway, I said, we'll get rid of them today. We always do. So thank you. You're always so very, very generous, and Pregnancy Care Center appreciates that so very, very much. Man, in two Sundays from today, it is graduation Sunday. We have 13 seniors in a high school group this year. 13 seniors. It's incredible. That's a good thing and it's a bad thing. It's wonderful for them because they're graduating and they're going to college. It's a bummer for the youth group. 13 is a big vacuum, all right, that goes out. Then that just means we got eighth graders coming up. But it's always an exciting time of year. And we'll be honoring all of our graduates in our morning services on June the 12th. So if you have a son or a daughter, we want them in one of our two 9:15 or 10:45 services that day. Vacation Bible School is going to be the end of June the 27th through July 1st. So if you have children or grandchildren, get them signed up. It's going to be an evening VBS from 5:30 to 8, and the registration forms are over in our Children's Center. We call it the JAM Center. Jesus and Me is what JAM stands for. Or you can pick them up during the week in the office. Let me give you a date that's not in your bulletin, and it's a long ways away, but we're going to start talking about it now, and you'll be hearing more about it as the date gets closer. April 1st and 2nd, April Fool's Day, and the day following. That's a Saturday and a Sunday. A big event is coming to Fresno, Clovis. It's called Fresno City Fest. It's being done by the Palau Crusade. Many of you maybe have never heard of Luis Palau. Luis Palau is the Billy Graham of South America and Central America. He's done conferences and crusades all across the United States, literally around the world. The last one he did in the Fresno area was 1985. We were there. It was a terrific time for our church family at that moment, and I believe it will be another incredible time. Very different now than it was in 1985, the way they connect to the community. Some of you BMX bike riders, you're going to want to not miss this. They've got some of the best BMX bike riders that will be at this event. They will have athletes as well as Luis and his son Andrew that will be there to speak. It's going to be at the Save Mart Center area, all right, indoors and outdoors. We'll show you some video clips in the months to come so it gives you a better idea of what it's all about. But I want you to put it on your calendar. I want you to start praying for it today because I think our community as well as our state and on to our nation is in need of some transformation. I'm a pretty positive guy, all right? I survived the 60s and the 70s. And I'm pretty enthusiastic most of the time, but I've never been as troubled about our nation, about what's going on from the grassroots all the way to the top as I am right now. And this is part of what today's sermon is actually about, out of the Psalm. Psalm 85 is a term that we don't toss around much anymore, but it's a word called revival. Literally means refreshing, renewing. And there needs to be a refreshing and a renewing of God's activity in our nation. Do you realize there are now other countries sending missionaries to the U.S.? We used to be the largest missionary sending agency in the world, and we probably still are. But churches in other countries are recognizing the anti-Christ presence in this country to a point that other nations are sending missionaries to our country. That tells us a little bit about the condition that we're probably in. And so we're going to keep you posted. We're going to be heavily engaged with the Luis Palau City Fest when it comes here, and you will hear more about it. Just wanted to give you a little teaser today, all right? June the 11th, all right, men's breakfast. Ray Steele, sitting right back there, is going to be our men's breakfast speaker that day. You're not going to want to miss that. Let me highlight a couple of prayer requests that are not in your bulletin. One of them is Donna Walters. She normally sits on that back row right there, center aisle. And Donna's not been able to be with us for a couple of weeks. She has some nerve damage in her back. It's causing her a lot of pain. She's going through some testing and stuff. And so please remember to pray for Donna Walters. Jan Patton is home from the hospital. That is exciting stuff, man. On Wednesday, for those of you who don't know, Jan Patton is the lady in Clovis that was stabbed 7 times by a boarder at her home. She was in the hospital for over a month now. She was in intensive care and unconscious for over 2 weeks. And the past week, she finally got to get to the physical therapy unit at Community Hospital, went through a week of recovery, and she is home, and she is doing much, much better, and we're grateful for that. Continue to remember Polly Good as she's trying to gather strength after a lot of chemotherapy. Tim Belcher, normally in this service, sitting on that row right about there, big, tall Tim. Tim is in West Virginia today. His cousin in her 60s died unexpectedly of a massive stroke last week. This is a kicker. Tim Belcher, 4 years ago, did not know Jesus Christ. Former Bullard High principal and Fresno Unified staff administrator. And he didn't know Christ. I get to know more about Tim than I do a lot of you because we're in the same small group together. When he started in our small group, he said, "Do not ask me any questions. Do not ask me to pray. I don't know anything." Our last Bible study, he led. He led. All right, he led in prayer. He did the study work for the questions. He led the discussions. Tim has grown immensely in his faith in Christ. And he goes back every year to see his relatives in West Virginia. And his cousin was a Christian, was a believer. But they asked him to come back and to share his faith at the funeral. And so that is this afternoon. And so I want you to be praying for Tim Belcher as he shares with the family there today. Richard Brown, also part of our church, his mom Marguerite has been in the hospital several times over the last few months, was to have 2 surgeries this week. They did the first one on Thursday. The one that they attempted to do yesterday, they had to stop because their blood clots are so big that until they can get the blood clots down, they cannot. It would be life-threatening for them to do the surgery. So we would appreciate you remembering to pray for Marguerite. All right. So those are some of the updates that we wanted to share with you. Would you join with me as we pray? Our ushers will come and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. And our offertory today, I believe, is a little taste of giggles and goodies. Okay. Let's pray. Our Father, thank you for the life that you share with us. Thank you for the privilege that every moment of every day we can walk in step, in fellowship, in unison with you. And Father, today, what I pray for is I want to thank you for your forgiveness for those moments in my life when I've chosen either willfully, but more frequently than not, simply out of neglect to walk in step with you, to not consider what's your wisdom, not to consider what is your direction, not to pause even long enough to pray, Lord, what is your desire in my life at this moment? Father, thank you for your graciousness to love us in spite of our neglect. And the thing I've come to discover is that spiritual growth, a good indicator of spiritual maturity, is when the times that we walk with no regard for you become fewer and fewer and farther apart. And so, Father, I pray that for us who have gathered today, that this will be the beginning of a greater sense of awareness, of consistency in walking life in unison with you. Paul called it walking by the Spirit. And so, Father, I trust that as we die to our own selfishness on a daily basis, that we seek your wisdom for how to live today. Father, I pray for an outpouring of your activity in our midst today as we attempt to look at a key psalm that David left for us thousands of years ago. It is so perfect for the times in which we live in. Father, we trust you with the needs that we've shared and also for those other needs that may be personal and private to those who've gathered. You know intimately about each and every one of them. And we pray for your activity in us as you want to work in each of these areas. For the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thanks. In the awesome, strong name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. I invite you, if you would, take your Bibles and find Psalm 85. We're going to be reading from there in just a few minutes. Psalm 85. If you also want to put your finger in Jeremiah 18. So Psalm 85 and Jeremiah 18, we'll be looking there in just a few minutes. If you're new to New Hope today, it's your first time here. We're in the middle of a series we're going to be in all year long. A year-long sermon series is not very popular anymore. I've shared this a time or two, but all the studies are indicating that pastors need to keep their sermon series to 4 to 6 weeks because that's all that the congregations can handle. I got news for you. Y'all look smarter than that to me, all right? I think you can handle more. I think maybe one of the reasons we might find our nation in the condition that it's in is because we've sold people too short. And we also haven't dug deep enough into the well of God's truth that we continue to flourish and grow. And so we're in a series called The Less, More Lifestyle. And really what it comes back to is, what are things in my life I want less of, and what are things in my life I want more of? We kind of do this at the end of a year and the beginning of a new year. As we make New Year's resolutions, I want less weight and more shape, all right? I want less debt and, you know, more cash. And so what I've asked you to do as a church family is to pray about in the spiritual realm, not necessarily in our economic realm or our health realm, though there's nothing wrong with that less, more lifestyle there as well. But I've asked you to prayerfully consider, what is it in your life where you are in your spiritual maturity? What are the things that you believe God would like to work on in your life that you need less and more of? Less fear, more faith. Less worry, more trust. Less anxiety, more peace. And those are just examples. God can work that out in your life. And I've asked you to write it down on a piece of paper. I provided you the paper the first month, all right? But write up and tuck it away in your Bible. And refer to it often and be in prayer about that. See how God directs you in that area. And when we get to December, we're going to pull those pieces of paper out again. And we're going to do a little... This is kind of like going to Weight Watchers, all right? We're going to do a little follow-up, all right? You're going to stand on the scale and see if there's less or more, all right? Less of the right, wrong things and more of the right things. We've talked about that there are four steps in this process. To have that kind of less, more lifestyle, there's four steps. We haven't done this in a month, so let's see how well you do on this. What's the first step in this less, more lifestyle? Choice. You have to choose, okay? God's not going to force it on you. You got to choose to want it, just as you do in your other resolutions. Once you make a choice, what does that choice need to be? Consistent, all right? There needs to be consistent. It's not a once-and-done choice. I just don't decide to be 10 pounds lighter, and I get there. That's a choice I make every single day. I don't choose less fear and more faith and say, okay, that's the way the rest of my life is going to be. There's got to be this development, this growth process. Once we make the choice and that choice is consistent, what really is advantageous to maintain consistency? Accountability. Ask somebody to be your accountability partner. I know this is risky. If you're married, ask your spouse because they're going to know when you're messing up. All right, they're going to be the best one. Okay, parents, ask your kids. That's really dangerous, okay? But have somebody hold you accountable in this area. And then the fourth thing, and it's the reason that we've chosen the Psalms as our course of study this year. But once we make a choice, we need to be consistent with that choice. What aids consistency is accountability. And then the real linchpin to this whole thing is number four, contemplation. Something that 21st century living and lifestyle doesn't give us much time to do. Contemplate. That's the slow, thoughtful process of the Scriptures. Okay? Contemplate the Scriptures. Investigate them. Look at them. See what they have to say to where you are in life. How many of you recognize, and I don't expect there to be many of you, how many of you recognize the name Ray Stedman? Okay, six of you. All right, here's why you probably don't know him. Number one, he died in the 1990s, okay? And you've slept since then, so you probably would have forgotten if you ever heard of him. Number two, he wasn't necessarily nationally or internationally known, but he was a leading pastor in the country at Peninsula Bible Church up in Northern California for about 30 years. And he did some pretty innovative things. But Ray was an outstanding communicator and writer. I loved to listen to Ray preach. And I didn't find out till this week, some research I was doing, I came across a quote of Ray Stedman's I'm going to share with you in just a moment. But do you know who the first two interns, pastoral interns, that Ray Stedman brought to his church at Peninsula Bible and trained them for a year after they finished their Bible college and seminary work before they launched into ministry? The first two interns ever at his church at the same time, Luis Palau and Chuck Swindoll. Holy smokes. What pastor wouldn't like those two guys as their interns, man? But that tells me something, too, about why Luis Palau turned out to be the kind of man he was and that Chuck Swindoll turned out to be the kind of pastor that he was. It was the influence of this guy by the name of Ray Stedman. And by the way, you can Google him and you can go to a website and you want to do some really good Bible studies. They're online there and done by Ray Stedman. But here's what Ray said. Ray said the Psalms, the study of the Psalms, is a study about worship from an honest heart. It's the study of worship from an honest heart. I've had a couple of you all over the last month tell me, Tim, the Psalms, the hymn book of the Old Testament, I love going through it, but man, it's kind of raw. I mean, there's always bad stuff in somebody's life. And I looked at him and I said, isn't there always bad stuff in your life? He said, yeah, but I don't like to be reminded of it. And we don't, but that's part of the reason we end up back in the bad stuff. It's because we're not reminded of what it was like. And so he always ends with a note of praise, but before he gets to the praise, he often lays out all of his dirty laundry. He's honest about, man, well, I've made a mess of my life. God, thank you that you haven't given up on me. And we find that again and again in the Psalms. So I love what Stedman had to say. And after that, he made this next comment. He said, the Psalms are designed to teach us one thing, and that is to worship no matter where we are. These Psalms reflect every human emotion, but they do so in a very important way. They are emotions that are connected to our relationship with God. This book, this hymn book called the Psalm, teaches us how to be honest before God. I asked the 8 o'clock service a question. I'm going to ask you the question. Have you ever been dishonest in your prayer life? Okay, you all didn't give me quite the same look the 8 o'clock crowd did. I think it was just early for them. All right, they looked at me like, are you nuts? You know, I mean, what are you talking about, dishonest? Have you ever lied to God in prayer? Yeah, and sometimes we don't out and out lie, but we just don't tell them stuff. If your kids don't tell you stuff, what'd you tell them? You just lied to me, all right? You didn't give me the whole truth. Well, how often do we do that when we go to talk to God in prayer? We come, and I don't know if any of you have ever done this. Maybe it's just me. I was in my mid-20s before I figured out that was a dumb thing to do. But I used to sit and think about what I was going to pray during my devotions before I prayed it so that it would sound better to God. Now, you got to understand, by the time I was in my late 20s, I was already, I had 2 degrees, all right, in biblical studies. And I'm still thinking about this God that I know is omniscient, who knows everything. He knows every thought I've ever had. And here I'm thinking about, okay, how am I going to say this so I look better when I talk to God? And one day I'm sitting there having that thought, and I'm thinking, you big dummy. God's hearing you right now. And so I quit doing that. But I got to be honest, it's easy if you're not careful. You step and think, okay, God, how does... God already knows. And what I love about David here is he bears his soul. He gives it. It's okay. It's okay to be openly honest before God. I got to tell you, I'm not going to come anywhere close to finishing today's sermon. So don't worry about it. I finished on time over there. That was amazing. I've been troubled all week. This message has been challenging for me. And the reason is because it coincides so much with where we are, I think, as a nation. This is Memorial Weekend, so I think it's appropriate that we are investigating the passages that we're looking at. And here's part of my challenge is I'm going to be using some terms and I'm going to be talking about some principles that you all are going to look at me and say, God, he's gotten old. Or what in the heck is he talking about? And that's what has me worried. That's what really has me worried. I mean, most of you know me, some of you don't. I'm pretty upbeat. I'm pretty excited about life. And I still am. But I'm troubled about the times that I'm living in. I survived the 60s and the 70s. And I really do believe that the season we are in America right now is as bad as it's ever been. And where does it start? Actually, amen is okay, but oh me is probably more appropriate at the moment. You see, here's what I believe should be the goal of a life of a person in love with Jesus Christ. I believe our life ought to be God-centered in our thoughts. And what I mean by that, man, if my life is God-centered, then I don't make decisions about business. I don't make decisions about relationships. I don't make decisions about hobbies. I don't make decisions about my time without thinking about Him and His wisdom. God-centered in my thoughts. I also want to be God-fearing in my heart. And by God-fearing, I'm not mean that I'm scared to death of God like He's got this big billy club waiting to pounce on me. But I got to understand, I'm finite. He's infinite. When I stand next to a guy who's 6'8", even though he may be my friend, I'm a little bit in awe. Because I'm 5'8". Always wanted to be 6'5". Never made it. But I ought to be God-fearing. I should not want to make decisions that are contrary to this God who I've centered my thoughts in. And not only want to be, but I also want to be God-honoring in all that I do. For those of you who are teens and college students, honor God with the career choice that you make. Honor God with the decisions you make about dating. Make those decisions before you ever go on the date. That means the person that I date as well as my behavior with the people that I date. Before you ever get married, make decisions that are God-honoring in your marriage. Is this person, this man or this woman that I'm going to commit to? And I probably don't need to clarify, but this is part of the times in which we're living in. Marriage is God's design between a man and a woman. That's gotten very blurred in our society today. And even to say that, I could be accused of hate speech, and it isn't. But before I enter into that relationship with a man or a woman, and I want to commit my life to it, the question I need to ask is, can my life honor God in this relationship? As I enter into a career, is this career going to enable me to honor God? As I spend my money, is the way in which I spend my money honoring God? So a few more questions for you. Are there any absolute truths that you live your life by? Are there any absolute truths that you live your life by? Yes, no? Okay, I'm not sure what that answer is, but that's okay. Let me ask you another question. Is there a source of absolute authority in your life? See, if you're a Christian, I would expect you to say yes. If you're uncertain if you're a Christian, I could understand if you don't say yes or I don't know. But as a person who says that they're Christian, there ought to be some absolutes in our life. How many of you know the Ten Commandments? I'm not going to ask you to repeat them, but how many of you know about Ten Commandments? That there are ten of them, right? All right? They're not the Ten Suggestions. They are the Ten Commandments. All right? God intended those. Those have not changed, though those were given in Old Testament times. Even though we live in a period of grace, there's nothing about those Ten Commandments that have changed one bit. The first five commandments are about our relationship with God and our parents. Okay? First four are about a relationship with God. Number five, honor your father and your mother. All right? The next five are about the way in which we live in community, in society. In God. And if you look at most of the laws and legislations in many governments, they have their roots out of these five things. Here's what they are, in case you don't remember them. You shall not murder. Do you all agree with that? You probably ought not to murder. Okay. So would you say that's an absolute for you? Okay. I'm not gonna murder anybody. I hope that's an absolute for you. Because right now all of you are pointing at me. Okay? So number two, how many of you, it says you shall not commit adultery, okay? Now, I'm not going to ask you to say that one out loud because that can be embarrassing, okay? Here's the deal. That term adultery in the Old Testament framework, that was a large tent, okay? That was a term that covered a lot. What that means is I'm not going to be engaged in sex outside of marriage. Is that an absolute in your life? Don't say yes out loud, all right? I 4 years ago, I preached a series of sermons of things I hate to preach about, and one of them was this subject, and I had never preached on the subject before like this. I preached on marriage, but I'd never dealt with this, and I did four weddings in my office over the next 2 months, 3 months. And here's what broke my heart. Pastor, we've been coming for a couple of years. We really knew that this it probably wasn't right to live together, but nothing was ever said, so we thought it might be okay. Thank you for preaching about it. And then I felt very convicted that I had not said more. You see, you just assume everybody, oh, no, we live in a time in which, no. The Bible says you shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not covet. Those are the second five. So do you believe in absolutes? If so, have you nailed down what those absolutes are according to the commandments? Let me ask the questions another way. Is it okay ever to beat your parents? No, the Ten Commandments says honor your father and mother. There are some parents who probably on occasion should be beat. Okay? But you never do it. You shouldn't do it. Is there ever an occasion when it's okay to murder somebody? I'm not talking about war, okay? I'm talking about I don't like you, so boom. You made me mad, boom. No. Is it okay to sleep with your boss's wife, your neighbor's husband, or a prostitute? No, it probably isn't. Is it okay to rob a bank, steal a car, shoplift? Those are absolutes then, right? Those are absolutes in your life. Is it okay to lie about your best friend, gossip about your children, or make up stories about your neighbor? No, thou shalt not covet. A few more questions. Do you believe God exists? I have a sneaking suspicion if you're in church, you're at least exploring the idea. You're checking it out. Do you believe that God loves you? Do you believe that God wants a relationship with you? Okay, next question. This is one you can answer this one. Do you believe that God knows best? For me, that's unequivocal. God knows better about me than I know about me. Do you seek God's leadership for every... Don't answer out loud. Do you seek God's leadership for every decision and every action that you make? See, if God knows best, why don't we? If we believe, if it's an absolute that God knows best, then why don't we? Do you think it's wise to obey God? Then on the heels of that question, do you? You see, guys, where I'm getting with all this is, does our belief in God, does it matter? And does it make a difference in the way in which we live? You see, this is important to me because this thing about our nation, we get this idea that life functions better from the top down, that if we listen to our president and Congress, life will be better. We get the idea that if we listen to the pastor in the church, life will be better. And the answer to both of those is no. Listen to God, and things will get better. And where that starts from is the grassroots up. If we want there to be a change in our government, it's not going to start with Congress. It's going to start with us. If we want something to be better in the church, it's not going to start with a pastor. It's going to start with us as individual members of a fellowship. Because God wants a willful relationship between us personally. And then from that personally, He then brings us together as a family, as a group. But it always starts one-on-one with God, and then He brings us under His direction into the group. And when you see the pouring out of God's blessing or the pouring down of God's judgment on a nation, it is not as a result of the government of the nation, it is a result of the people in the nation. Turn with me to the book of Jeremiah before I jump into Psalms 85. Jeremiah 18. I'm going to start reading at verse 5 and read through verse 12. Then the word of the Lord came to me. That's Jeremiah. O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter does, declares the Lord? Like clay in the hand of a potter, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. If at any time I announce that a nation or a kingdom is to be uprooted, torn down, and destroyed, and if that nation I warned repents of its evil, then I will relent and not inflict on it the disaster that I had planned. And if at another time I announce that a nation or a kingdom is to be built up and planted, and if it does evil in my sight and does not obey me, then I will reconsider the good I had intended to do for it. Now therefore say to the people of Judah, say to the people of Clovis, and those living in Jerusalem, Fresno County, this is what the Lord says. Look, I'm preparing a disaster for you and devising a plan against you. So turn from your evil ways, each one of you, and reform your ways and your actions. But they will reply, it's no use. Why? Because we're going to continue in our own plans. Each of us will follow the stubbornness of our own evil heart. That's pretty serious stuff, isn't it? And though that was written thousands of years ago, it is applicable to us today as much as it was to Israel then. I think we're in a nation that's at a crossroad of judgment. And the question is, are we going to repent and God revise His plan, and instead of judgment bring blessing once again? Or will we be like the people in Israel and Judah were that day and say, I'm going to follow the evil in my own heart? Let's read Psalm 85, because David deals with this on a personal level. Jeremiah dealt with it on a national level. David, on a personal and national level, deals with this very same thing in Psalm 85. So let me just read the chapter and make some observations as we go through it. David wrote this. You showed favor to your land, O Lord, and you restored the fortunes of Jacob. You forgave the iniquity of your people, and you covered all of their sins. At the end of that passage, it says, Selah. Do you know what Selah means? It means think about it. Think about it. So David said, what I just said to you, you ought to think about. And then he says, you set aside all of your wrath and you turned from your fierce anger. In those three verses, we have God's fourfold activity of grace. Let me just point it out quickly to you. Fourfold activity of God's grace. Verse 1, you showed favor. Second part of verse 1, you restored. Verse 2, you forgave the iniquity. Verse 3, you set aside your wrath. That's God's grace. He shows favor. By His Spirit, He convicts us and invites us to have a relationship with Him. When we step into that relationship with Him, He restores the fortunes. What's that? He restores the Holy Spirit now to our life, restores to us what was lost in Adam and Eve's sin in the garden. You forgive the iniquity. The slate is wiped clean. My sins are no more. And you set aside your wrath. I'm no longer judged. I'm now blessed. That's grace. Then he jumps into verse 4 and he says, restore us again. Oh God, our Savior. What is inferred just in that phrase? What's David saying is the condition of his own life and his people? Yeah, it's all screwed up. It's all messed up. You don't need to restore a brand new house, do you? You only have to restore what's messed up. David says, restore us, and then notice what's the next word? Again. We screwed up again, God. Remember, Psalms, honest worship. God, I blew it again. I blew it again. Will you restore us? Put away your displeasure towards us? Will you be angry with us forever? You remember when you disappointed your parents? It seemed like they were mad at you forever. It might have just been overnight, but it seemed forever. David says to God, God, boy, it seems like I've screwed up so often that you're mad at me all the time. Will you prolong your anger through all generations? Will you not, here's the key, will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? Without revival, there's no rejoicing. Without restoration, there is no revival. And without restoration and revival, there will be no genuine rejoicing. See, this word revival means to renew our walk and our worship and our work. It literally means improvement, recovery, rallying. It's refreshing to be revived. Keep reading. Show us your unfailing love, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. I will listen to what God the Lord will say. He promises peace to His people, to His saints, but let them not return to folly. There's two keys to enjoying the promises of God. The first one is you got to listen to them, and the second thing is you got to respond to them. Listen and then respond. Don't return to your folly. Don't go back to foolishness. Why in the world, if you tried to live life on your own and you failed miserably at it, why do you keep going back to it? Surely His salvation is near those who fear Him, that His glory may dwell in our land. Love and faithfulness meet together. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. Faithfulness springs forth from the earth, and righteousness looks down from heaven. The Lord will indeed give what is good, and our land will yield its harvest. Righteousness goes before Him and prepares the way for His steps. The psalmist asks God a most important question in this chapter. He says, will you not revive us again? David was concerned. Because David was concerned then, I've got to be honest, I'm concerned today. When I was growing up, we sometimes would sing a hymn in the church called Revive Us Again. Some of you remember it, okay? If you're under 40, you probably never heard it, okay? Revive us again. Fill each heart with Thy love. Rekindle a fire that comes down from above. Israel knew what it was. David knew what it was to walk in revival victory. It was a place and time where they lived without a doubt that God was the most important thing in their life. So let me ask you, not for you to answer out loud, is God the most important thing in your life? Is that the most important relationship that you have? And evaluate in the concept of time and thought that you invest into it. Most of you know, I love my dad. Been blessed to have a wonderful relationship for as long as I've been alive with him. I don't know that we ever got very contrary with each other. He doesn't have his ears in, so he can't hear me very well. But and those moments that they were did not last very long. This relationship is exceedingly important to me. But as important as this relationship is, it is not the most important relationship that I have. And you want to know who taught me that? My dad. My dad, by his example, taught me that he could love me best when he loved God more. And I watched my dad obey God at times that sometimes from an outward perspective look like it wasn't the wisest decision to make. From a circumstantial perspective, some of the choices it looked like would not be as prosperous as I wanted life to be. You see, where I think I have failed as a parent, it's what I learned from my grandparents and my parents was this. That what they wanted for themselves and what they wanted for me that was number one important was a right, healthy relationship with God. I never, that was an absolute in my family's life, and I understood that. Did I always like that? No, but I understood it. And from this perspective, it's the best thing they did. You see, I think sometimes, though I think all of our kids know how important God is to us, I'm not sure I gave them the same level of value that my family gave to me. I think we've developed a culture almost, if we're not really careful, that what we want for our kids is we want them to be really happy and we want them to be really educated and we want them to be really successful. And you know what I've come to believe about my own kids? I'd rather they be poor and uneducated and not very successful in the eyes of the world as long as I know that they love Christ. Because you can have an abundance of those other things. You can have all of those other things and not have a good relationship with God. And so this idea that God was the most important thing in David's life and in the nation of Israel, in order for there to be the blessings of God temporarily while on earth, but forever one day in heaven, has got to be most important. And the question is that true for you and me today? Is that absolute that this is the most important thing that I have in my life? Revival is not evangelism, even though many people might get saved as a result of revival occurring in a community or in a country. Revival is not emotionalism, though we sometimes might have emotional manifestations during this time of refreshing and renewal. But what revival literally is, it is a renewal of the spiritual life in an individual and amongst God's people together. Guys, we need that in the church in America today. We need that here. Status quo is not acceptable. Someone asked the question, when is revival needed? I thought of another question. When is it not needed? It's needed whenever the love of God's people has grown cold or distant. Has the love of God seemed to grow cold in our country, in our state, in our community? How about has it grown cold in this small place of your heart? And what's the cause for that? Oh, we can blame lots of... You can blame me because I don't preach good sermons. Not true. Not the part that I don't preach good sermons. That might be true. But it's not my fault. Your heart is cold. I could say, you know what, it's because, God, these people you gave me to pastor, they're so annoying. That's not true. But I could say that as an excuse. But that would not be true. If my heart is cold, if your heart is cold, it's because you and I have allowed our hearts to grow cold in our relationship with Jesus Christ. Pure and simple. No other excuse. We could say, hey, look at the bad things that have happened to me. Yeah, who made most of those choices that prompted those bad things to happen to you? David admits in these Psalms, hey, I screwed up. I messed up. God, forgive me now. Would you revive and restore to me because of what I've done? Has the fire in your heart that was so strong, has it diminished because of day-to-day responsibilities and the natural things of life? Hey, it's not easy to live life day by day, man. It requires work. You got to have a paycheck. You got to have food. You got to keep up the yard. You got to take, you know, you got to clean the house. Well, some people don't, but you should. You should. And so life gets tough. And so we give God our leftovers rather than our priorities. Consider the symptoms that revival has grown cold in our midst. Here's some characteristics that let us know that. Number one, complacency. We are self-satisfied with the status quo. We've become self-serving and not a God-serving people in this world. Number two, we have a lack of concern for those who don't know Christ. Our daily needs become more important than their eternal needs. Number three, we hide secret sins. We do things that we think no one else will find out about. Here's the deal. If you believe the relationship with God is essential, if you believe that it is an absolute in your life, guess what? He knows what you're up to. He knows it. And that's the one that counts. Number four, when we hold on to bad feelings towards others, even fellow believers. We hold a grudge. This creates an obstacle in our walk, and it causes us to withdraw from our fellowship with God and His church. Number five, when we have an unforgiving spirit, we're not able to let loose of our sin or forgive others of their sins, and this causes a greater separation in the fellowship and even from God. And how foolish is this path? Number six, we're filled with pride. That's original sin. It's what prompted Adam and Eve in the garden to mess up. Why do we hold on to pride so dearly? Let me ask you this. If you had a 100-pound bag of horse manure and you carried it around on your back every day, how would you like that? That would seem kind of stupid, wouldn't it? I mean, I have a little pooper scooper for my dog, and you know, I fill it up once, and I'm ready to get rid of it. And it doesn't even smell all that bad, but I don't get that close. But why would I carry around a 100-pound bag of manure? Why do we carry around our pride? And then number seven, any condition of spiritual standing where we are less today than we were before, that's a problem. Do you know what that was called in my grandfather and my father's day? Hardly ever use the term anymore. It's gone out of date. It's called backsliding. We just like to preach about the grace of God and how it forgives all of our sins, and I believe that with all of my heart. But we've gotten to a point where we act like God's grace is this wonderful thing, that it's okay if I screw up. I don't have to be held accountable for it by it anymore because God's grace covers all that. Yes, it does, but it does not mean you will not have consequences to your going backwards in your relationship with God. There will be consequences. I remember the invitations of churches, the churches that I grew up in, and the invitations, whether by my dad or whether by visiting pastors or evangelists in our church, would always go like this, the closing hymn, all right? There would be the first verse, and that invitation, almost exclusively, if you are here today and you've never invited Jesus Christ in your life, and you want forgiveness of your sin, you want to know that when you die, you don't go to hell, but you go to heaven, would you step out today, come down front, give your life to Jesus Christ, we'd love to pray with you. And most of the services, much like you all here today, most of you have already done that. But they always opened it up. They would always say something like this, if you don't want to walk forward, that's okay. You can invite Christ in your life right where you're seated, and you can. But the second verse always went like this, you know, hey, there may be some of you here, you're regulars here. but maybe you've messed up. You've got a cold heart. You've backed away from your relationship with Christ. Why don't you come forward and we'll join together and we'll deal with that today. Maybe we need a little more of that today so that we don't give our hearts the opportunity to cool down from the fire of Christ's life which has come to be in our lives. You see, revival, it's effective, but it's elusive. In previous times in Israel's history, Israel, as well as David himself, experienced the refreshing of God's presence and the realness of God's power, and on a daily basis, the reassurance of God's promises. But, according to verse 8, they turned back to folly. David knew what it was to experience the vibrancy of a fire in his life for a love for God, and he also knew what it was to be rebuked and reproved and remorseful because he had messed up. Let me close with this thought, and we'll pick up right back in Psalm 85 next week. Let me close with this thought. We don't have revival by seeking revival. We have revival only by seeking God. And so my challenge to us as a fellowship over these next few weeks, actually it needs to be a way of life, but over these next few weeks for us to really evaluate, am I seeking God as the absolute of my life in the decisions that I make and the actions I carry out, in the choices that I make? Am I seeking God first? I'm afraid if the Church of God in this nation doesn't get a fire of revival lit in our hearts, it is going to be drastic for the next generation. And we bear that responsibility. Let's pray. Father, there very well may be some of us here who need to repent. We've allowed our hearts to grow cold in some area of our life. And Father, when we allow that in any area of our life with you, it impacts every area of our life. Father, we cruise along. We sort of live our life on cruise control. We allow other things to have preeminence in our life so that you're not even a priority anymore. And so, Father, I pray that for each of us, we will open ourselves up to the full light of your Scriptures and the full examination of your Holy Spirit. And, Father, we will give you the freedom to transform our lives so that by transforming our lives, we become the conduit of your blessing to others who are around us, that we will not be selfish about our own likes and dislikes, but we will become selfless in your love, and by that we will become better at loving others. We'll become your conduit for revival in our community, in our state, and in our country. Father, our circumstances may look hopeless, but you fill us with hope. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day. Hope to see you next Sunday.